Welcome. I am Dr. Cassandra Marion, Science Advisor at the Canada Aviation and Space Museum, and here with me today is Dr. Farah Alibay, a Canadian systems engineer at NASA's Jet Propulsion Laboratory. Dr. Alibay has a wealth of experience on robotic space missions and plays an important role in the Mars 2020 Perseverance rover mission. Perseverance is nearly done its seven-month journey and will land on Mars very soon on February 18th, 2021. Welcome, Dr. Alibay. So glad to have you with me today.
Yeah, thank you for having me.
So please tell us a bit about the Mars 2020 Perseverance rover mission.
Yeah, so Perseverance, as you mentioned, has been on its way to Mars for the past 7 months. And on February 18, 2021, it'll be landing on Mars. And it is the most complex rover we have ever built and sent to another planet. I think every time we go to Mars, we kind of like surpass ourselves. And Perseverance in particular is landing in the delta of a river, well, an ancient river, it's a dried up river called Jezero Crater. It's actually a river that goes into a dried up lake bed, and it's going to look for signs of ancient life. So it's going to traverse that delta and the area around there. And using its robotic arm and its drill, it's also going to collect samples that it's going to put inside the rover itself. It has a caching system. It's going to seal up those samples and leave them on the surface of Mars, because the goal is that Perseverance is the first step in the Mars sample return mission. So eventually, if we find enough good samples and we're excited about them, we'll send another mission to go pick them up and bring them back to Earth.
And what is your role in the Mars 2020 rover mission?
So I'm an engineer on the mission, which means that, you know, leading up to this moment, I was part of the team that helped build the rover. I did a lot of the testing, the system testing, both on the flight vehicle, but also we have a twin of Perseverance called Optimism that we have out here in LA. And we have kind of like a big sandblock where we called the Mars Yard, where we test out our rover, do a lot of like the driving and navigation. And I'm part of the mobility team. So I helped test out everything that has to do with navigating the rover. Because on Mars, we don't have GPS, we don't have maps, right? So we have to be a little smarter about how we do navigation. And so my job was to help test all of that out and be ready to land on Mars and drive on Mars when we get there. Now I'm transitioning and I'm more on the operations team. So I'll be part of the team that operates the rover from a day to day. And so every day, especially in the first few months after we land, we'll be working during the Martian night. The rover will be working during the Martian day. And so every night we'll be getting down information from the rover, looking at what they did, and then creating a new plan, essentially programming a plan for the next day to bring that up to the rover. So I'm one of the people that helps coordinate that whole planning process and making sure that it all gets done on time, so that when the rover wakes up in the morning, it knows what to do.
And how does Perseverance land? Why is this term the seven minutes of terror? What's that about?
So one of the difficulties with Mars and Mars operations is that Mars is actually pretty far away. I mean, it seems obvious, but it is millions of kilometers away. So the way that we communicate with our rovers is using radio signal, the same as, you know, you would use in your car when you're getting radio. Radio signal goes at the speed of light. So it's incredibly fast. It's as fast as we can go, but it's still not all that fast. It takes somewhere between 7 or 12 minutes for a radio signal to leave from Earth to get to Mars. And similarly, it takes 7 to 12 minutes, depending on the time of year, for a signal from the rover to get to Earth. So the reason why our landing period is called 7 minutes of terror is because it takes approximately 7 minutes to land, you know, from the moment we hit the atmosphere until the moment that we touch on the surface of Mars. That sequence takes 7 minutes. However, all of it has to be automated because we couldn't, you know, direct it in real time to enter the surface of Mars. So the craziest thing that you have to think about is on Earth, when we first get the signal that Perseverance has entered the atmosphere of Mars, actually the signal that we're getting is 7 to 12 minutes old because it's traveled that whole distance to, you know, to get to Earth. So the reality is, you know, if you're watching landing and realizing that we're, you know, on the feed, we're saying like, oh, Perseverance has entered the atmosphere. Well, actually, Perseverance is already on the surface of Mars. We just don't know whether it's, you know, safely on the surface of Mars or not. So it is very nerve-wracking because it's something that we've worked on for sort of years and years, and there's literally nothing we can do. When it happens, we're sitting back and watching with you, you know, as landing happens, because we've automated everything and we're just essentially watching the playback. You also asked about, you know, how does landing work? So the way that we land on Mars in this particular case, Perseverance is pretty heavy. And so we need multiple systems to slow us down as we're as we're entering the Martian atmosphere. So, you know, we're traveling extremely rapidly right now. And our goal is from the moment we hit the atmosphere to the moment we get on the surface of Mars, we want to be traveling at, you know, a few meters per second and land softly. So we first enter the atmosphere. We have a heat shield that we angle into the atmosphere to slow us down. So you see that kind of burn up, and it slows us down as we enter the atmosphere. So that takes out quite a bit of our speed. Then once we are about, you know, 8 kilometers from the surface, we deploy our parachute. The parachute does a good job at slowing us down. It, you know, it brings us down to maybe the last couple of kilometers, but it's not enough. One of the challenges with the Martian atmosphere is that a lot of people say, you know, it's thick enough that you have to worry about it, meaning, you know, you get that burning up on entry, but it's so thin that it's actually useless because you can't slow yourself down completely with a parachute the way you might on Earth. So, you know, once we hit that sort of 2 kilometer-ish distance, we actually cut off the parachute, which is terrifying, right? We're like, all right, we're done with this. I'm just going to take it off here. And then, you know, within a split second of removing the parachute, we fire up, we have a jetpack that's attached to the rover that has little retro rockets. So we fire up those rockets, that slows down the rover even more. And that's really what removes the last of that velocity. And then as we get closer and closer to the surface of Mars, you know, eventually that jetpack lowers, it has nylon cables, and it lowers the rover directly down on the surface of Mars, wheels down, pretty much ready to go.
Awesome. So what's so special about the Perseverance rover?
There are, you know, a number of technology advancements that are coming, you know, with this rover. But I think what is especially, you know, which is incredibly special with it, is that it's the first formal astrobiology mission that we're doing. Like, we are going to Mars to look for signs of ancient life. We are looking for life on Mars. But the coolest part, right, is that we're collecting samples. Right? We're going to Mars. We bring our chemistry kit. That, you know, this may be my engineer's impression of all scientists, but the way that scientists, you know, design missions is they ask themselves questions, they have hypotheses, and then they, you know, based on that, they decide which instruments they want to bring, because there's only so many we can fit on the rover. And then every time we get somewhere, we get there and we're surprised every single time, right? Like, we get there and we bring our instruments and we're like, shoot, I really wish I'd brought this, or I really wish I had this, or maybe I need to go invent a new instrument to look at this particular phenomena. So the cool thing about being able to collect samples is that, you know, one day we'll bring them back to Earth, and that's gonna feed decades of science, because now we'll be able to share those samples across the scientific community. You know, if we see something, we can go build a new instrument. We can go, you know, have a big meeting and decide what we're going to do about this. And it's the first time that we'll have a set of samples, you know, in context from another planet. So so that's incredibly special. And it's going to be sort of a decade long activity that Perseverance is starting, right? It's kind of like a little bit stressful, because it's like, yeah, if you want to succeed at that whole mission, like, Perseverance has got to find those samples so that we can eventually bring them back.
And what challenges do you foresee navigating on Mars?
So one of the the big science goals for Perseverance is that we want to get a varied set of samples, right? So we don't want to just land somewhere, take a couple samples and go. We want to be able to drive around across the surface. And actually, that is one of the most ambitious science goals, is that we've had to improve our driving ability sort of by an order of magnitude. We want to be able to traverse really long distances. And so our rover is actually self-driving. And I'm part of the team that helped test all of that system. So, you know, self-driving cars on Earth, yeah, there's humans, there's other cars, like it's difficult in that sense, but at least you have roads, you have maps, you kind of know where you're going. Someone's been there before. For our Perseverance rover, you know, when we land on Mars, we've never been there before. We don't know what it looks like. We don't have to worry about little aliens coming and crashing into us, but we do have to worry about rocks, about terrain, and about not getting lost. And so that's some of the biggest challenges that we have is we can't just use an Earth system and make it work on Mars. We have to design a custom way of analyzing terrain, making onboard decisions and driving on that terrain. And so we don't drive very fast. We actually only drive at about 100 to 120 meters an hour. But the rover is actually able to fully self-drive, which means that at the end, you know, I told you that what we can plan the days for the rover. We can also say, okay, you know, you're done with your plan. Go ahead and drive 300 meters in that direction. We'll talk to you tomorrow. So the rover has the ability to do that. So you can just only imagine, right, like how much onboard knowledge it has to have. It also can't get lost, right? So it has to know contextually where it was, where it's been, where it is relative to Earth, because it has to know, okay, at 10 a.m. tomorrow when I call home, you know, Earth is going to be here in the sky and I'm going to point my antenna that way. So that's sort of just some of the complexities that I have to think about every day.
Can you tell us about the Mars helicopter Ingenuity?
Absolutely. Yeah. So one of the other hats that I wear actually is that I am the rover interface for the operations of the Mars helicopter Ingenuity. And Ingenuity is a separate mission that we're carrying on board with us. It's actually attached to the belly of the rover. And, you know, approximately in the first few months while we land, it's going to do a technology demonstration. It's actually going to demonstrate the first powered flight on Mars, which is really cool. The helicopter is currently attached on the rover. We're going to drive around, find it a nice, you know, a nice flat spot for it to go fly and drop it there. And then the rover becomes kind of like a telecom relay and personal photographer for the helicopter. So we'll have sort of a 30 sol period. A sol is a Martian day, where the helicopter is going to attempt to fly. It's going to start off using, you know, some simple flights, just trying to go up and down. And if we can at least demonstrate that, then we'll get more and more ambitious. But the idea of a technology demonstration like this is that it's a stepping stone. The rover is actually started as a technology demonstration from the Pathfinder mission. And now, you know, they've become sort of our staple of what we do on Mars. So with Ingenuity, again, all Ingenuity is demonstrating is that we can do something that we've never done before. And if we're able to do that, that opens so many doors in the future of, you know, potentially having other helicopters flying with rover missions in the future, or just having helicopter missions that can traverse a lot more complex terrain that that rovers ever could.
So what will your day look like driving the rover? Will you be living on Mars time?
Yes, I will be living on Mars time. And so Mars time is a strange concept, so we work during the Martian night because the rover, you know, wants to work during the day, and we're kind of nice to the rover, but also rover needs daylight to take images and things like that. So you think like, okay, that's simple. You just kind of shift your schedule and you work the night shift, right? Well, okay, yes, there is a time zone difference between, say, Los Angeles, where I am, and Perseverance landing spot on Jezero Crater. But the problem is that a Martian day, a sol, is a little bit longer than an Earth day. It's like 24 hours and 40 minutes, just about 40 minutes. which means that even if I start my day at the same time on Mars every night, which is, you know, we start at about 5, 6 p.m. every night. And, you know, maybe on landing day, that translates to about 3 p.m. LA time. But the next day, that 5 p.m. is 3:40, and then it's 4:20, and then it's 5 o'clock. So every day, my schedule shifts by 40 minutes, which, you know, it's fine when, you know, it goes from 6 to 6:40 to 7:20 in the morning when I don't have to wake up as early. But it does mean that, you know, I was looking at the schedule, some days I'll be waking up at 3 a.m. to go on shift. And it can be pretty difficult to be living with other humans around and being on this strange time. It's almost like you have to keep two clocks to know where you're going and when. Thankfully, we only do that for the first 90 sols. So we'll be doing that for 3 months. It's just a period. It allows us to work most efficiently. It allows us to get the rover from a point where, you know, it take off its training wheels and get it ready to really get into that science. And after that, we go sort of on a every other day cadence where we can work normal human hours and also have a life outside of work. But yeah, for 3 months, I'm going to be living on Mars, essentially.
What are you most excited about?
Oh, I am excited about so many things with the Perseverance mission. I think, you know, based on what my background is, which is both mobility and then working with the Ingenuity mission, the two big milestones that I'm most looking forward to is the first flight of Ingenuity on Mars, because even though I'm on the Perseverance mission, you know, being able to enable another mission to make history is pretty incredible. And then the other is the first time that we'll use the self-navigation system on Perseverance, which will be, again, a few months after landing. Because if you think about it, what's going to happen is, you know, we'll tell the rover, okay, let's go. And then the next morning when we wake up and get the first images of, you know, the rover will self-drive itself to a whole new place. And then we'll wake up and come to work and we'll be in a completely different place on Mars. Right. And so, you know, that feeling that you get on landing day when every time we land on Mars, you get a picture and it's shown to everyone and like, here's Mars, like we've landed in a new place. Well, when you're able to self-drive large distances every day, that feeling happens every day. Every day when I get to work, I'm going to see a place on Mars that no one else has seen before. And that's one of the most exciting things about this job, right, is that I get to be an explorer from, you know, from my home or from work. Every day when I come to work, I see scientific data and images of Mars that I'm one of the first humans to see that. So I'm essentially an explorer through the eyes and the ears of the rover itself.
Well, this is so exciting. I'm excited. Thank you, Dr. Alibay, for sharing your knowledge of the Perseverance rover mission with us. I really appreciate your contribution, and I wish you and the mission team a successful soft landing and future exploration of Mars.
Thank you so much.
A little note to our viewers to please follow Canada Aviation and Space Museum on Twitter and Facebook, as we'll be posting more on Perseverance in the coming weeks. Thank you and stay safe.